Hey guys, today I have this 2014 Chevy Silverado in the shop and I'm going to show you what it takes to put a sound system in without changing out the head unit. A lot of newer vehicles are already coming out with big screens with navigation and everything's integrated. The nice thing is you have all this. I don't agree with the design though because it's not modular. Because let's say something happens to this knob or something happens to one section down here, you're going to have to replace the whole thing. Unfortunately, this is what manufacturers are doing. So just so you know, but we don't have to change out the head unit if you want to add an aftermarket sound system. To achieve our goal of getting signal, we're going to be using Audio Control's LC2i. Now, what I'm going to be talking about in this video is only line output converters, or high-low adapters, whatever you want to call it. We're not going to cover digital signal processors or anything like that. That will be for another video. But to start off, I'd like to go over Audio Control's LC2i, because I think it's a really neat piece, and it's my go-to piece when it comes to doing basic installations where I have a full-range signal. Now, what the LC2i is, it is considered a line output converter, but that's to say it lightly. I like to consider it a hybrid in between a digital signal processor or a DSP and a line output converter. The reason being is DSP can correct a lot of curves in your EQ because some cars have like a really weird EQ and the signal's just messed up and it's one of those garbage in, garbage out kind of things. The LC2i does not correct any of that. So whatever signal you're putting in is going to put the exact signal out. What it does compensate for, though, is what's called bass roll-off. And a lot of newer cars, you can experiment with this. Have your volume about half. Sounds pretty full, sounds good. As you turn up the volume, it does get louder, but if you notice, the bass starts to go away. Manufacturers do that on purpose because they do engineer their speakers to fit well, but they don't use the most expensive components. So to stop the users from blowing up speakers, they engage what's called bass roll-off. So as you turn the volume up, that bass actually goes away. What the LC2i can do is it actually compensates for that. So when this thing starts to see the bass start to go away, it will put it back into your amplifier. So as you crank on it, that amplifier you spent a bunch of money on will actually put out bass. Another thing I like about the LC2i is I have my little sheet here that I was at training at the Mobile Electronic Expo and training. Ken Ward was there and he gave us this little chart of all the integration devices that are currently on the market that he likes. And if we see here the LC2i, the cool thing is it can handle up to 40 volts in. So a lot of line output converters are cheap, like, well, why don't I just buy the $25 one? Well, the reason being is you can't really adjust much on it or compensate for anything, and they can't handle a lot of voltage in. Yes, you should always measure with a multimeter because let's say it's putting out more than 40 volts, you might damage this. So you need to know what you're feeding into the unit, but it's pretty flexible. And you can see here, it is not a summing device.
So let's
say
you wanted to add in like a 4-channel or 5-channel, the LC2i is not exactly your go-to piece. Yes, it does have a main output and there's only a bass output, but I would not pick this. I would use the LC7i for that because the LC7i is designed for a multi-channel amplifier and you can sum signal. What I mean by sum signal is a lot of these cars, when you're grabbing, let's say on a Beamer, for example, if you just go into like the door speaker, it could be crossed over very high and you're not getting any bass. So then you would want to grab the signal off the sub as well. Well, you can actually combine those signals inside the unit, giving you full range coming out the pre-outs over here. That's something you'd want to do when you're doing a full-on system. So when you're doing a unit like this, you'd want to measure the frequency coming out with an oscilloscope or like an RTA, or maybe there's another installer that you know that just might know, hey, where do I grab signal from? But get the proper signal, because if I put in only 100 hertz and higher into this thing, that's all that's coming out. So all the lows that you're actually trying to get, like 80 and down, you're not going to get it out unless you put full range into this. So that's why I'm saying this isn't anything like a DSP, because if there's no frequency there, you can't correct it. So we're working on a Chevy Silverado. You could put this in the Dodge Ram, no problem. I have done this. I've tried it off the rear speakers. But what I tend to do is if I'm using this on a Dodge Ram and only getting subs, I'll just grab the sub signal and put it in, and then it gives me sub out. So, you know, like I said before, be careful of where you're grabbing signal from, because garbage in, garbage out. So over here, there is one downside to these. You can get these mixed up So make sure you remember that you're hooking up into the appropriate connections on the connectors here. And you don't always have to use the remote in. This is remote in if you don't want to do signal sensing. In the truck I'm working on, I did do signal sensing. It's called their GTO circuit. Where is it over? It's over here. So the jumper is defaulted to enabled. So it's actually going to look for voltage coming on the speaker lines to turn the unit on. If you don't want to do that because you're getting some sort of weird noise, or you just want the amp to turn off and on only with the ignition, then you'd switch over to bypass, and then you'd run a line, a 12 volt line in, to remote in. If you're not, you just leave that blank, and then 12 volts constant and ground. Here's your speaker level input, so this is where you grab full range preferably, and run it right into here. And now out here we have main output and bass. Now when, since we're only using this for monoblocks, just put it on the bass output. And then here we have all our levels, so we can actually adjust how aggressively we want the AccuBass to actually engage, and there's also another threshold here as well. And we can also adjust the gains of signal going into our amplifier. Don't crank on these. Leave it either default, or sometimes I even turn them down a bit, because sometimes these customers come in and I have to educate them on, they have the car comes in the bass settings all the way turned up. You need to flatten out everything but when you're tuning, and then tell the customer, do not turn the bass up because it will sound like crap. So these are all things you have to consider, and those really basic line output converters don't give you this adjustability at all. So it's because sometimes, like, you know, sometimes it's not enough signal, sometimes it's too much, and having the ability to turn it up and down can make all the difference of making your system sound better and also not destroy itself. On the side here, you see this port, which kind of looks like an Ethernet port. This allows you to add a remote gain control knob, and those knobs you can actually disassemble. What I like to do is I like to drill a hole in the panel, and then that way the knob looks like it's supposed to be there, because I don't like it hanging off the bottom of the dash. I think it looks cheesy. When you guys are wiring up these units as well, on the 12 volt constant and also on the remote in, there is no built-in fuse on the unit. As an extra measure of safety, I would highly recommend that you put a fuse in line on your power wires, just in case there is a short that you'll blow the fuse. That way, you're just safer that way. I've hidden the LC2i and the dash here of the Silverado up as high as I could. That way, if you were to peek your head from underneath here, you're not going to notice it. But if you need to make any adjustments, you just pull off this top cover, and then you can adjust your levels from there. Here's one of the points where I'm grabbing one of the points for signal. I'm just grabbing the rear speakers, and because I'm right running wires back here, it wasn't hard to take off this B pillar cover. And I have a database where I can look up all the wiring, but I also test as well with a multimeter, because you do not want to just tone generate wires, and especially these computer controlled vehicles. There are no airbags in here. But I've heard of guys, they'll take like a 9 volt or a tone generator, and they'll twisted wires, especially in Beamers. Like, I'm sure a lot of you've heard about this. The airbag wires in a Beamer are not yellow, and they're not marked, and they're twisted, and they look like speaker wires. If you just took a tone generator to it and popped it, it's going to engage the airbag. So what I use is a multimeter, and I hit the speaker, and I watch the resistance change, and that's how I know if I have a speaker or not. And then I have to determine polarity after that, because yes, you've identified the speakers, but if you wire them out of phase, you're not gonna get any bass out of your system. In case you're wondering what my ground looks like, what I do first is I grind off all the paint, so we have metal-to-metal contact. This already comes crimped from Stinger, and I add solder to the line to make sure that you can't pull the wire no matter what, pretty much. And then we use positive ground's actual self-threading bolt and their lock washer as well. And then what I do to seal it all is I use temporary film that you would use on like a rocker guard. It says temporary on, you can get it at your local auto parts store, and I spray over that. That way we have a good solid ground. Here I have my amplifier. It's an HD750 with JL Audio stealth enclosure. I really like these things when people just want to get their jobs done right away, because we're putting something that's custom, but it's built from the factory. These are hand-built in Florida, and they are built in-house, and I'm really fond of doing these systems. Here I have the amplifier. There's really no place to put an amplifier this big. I tried going under the seat. There's actually a bar. You can see that bar over there? That actually moves with the track, so you'd have to raise the seat if you went under the seat. There's no room behind the seats in these. There's no issues putting an amplifier on the enclosure. I have done it a bunch of times. It's just like you have no options, and in a basic installation, no one's building anything custom in this setup, so this is the place to put it. The other thing about this amplifier, the way I have it set up, is because a lot of vehicles have what's called wrap retain accessory power, so you take your key out, the stereo will still play running. If I hooked up the amplifier or my LC2i up to ignition and not use their GTO sensing, what would happen is as you take the key out, the whole system will shut down. So we're going to continue, we're using signal sensing. I know some people don't like it, but the signal sensing on the audio control piece is very good and very accurate. We're going to use that. That way, when you take the key out, the system just keeps on playing. And then when you open the door, the whole thing will shut off. Now, depending on the customer's needs, this will change. Maybe some people don't want to have the amplifier turn on, so I would hook it up to accessory. This particular setup, we're going to do signal sensing for it, though.
Well, guys, as you see, I am big deep into doing vehicle-specific setups in these vehicles. Hopefully you learned something new about how to add better sound quality to your existing sound system without overhauling the whole vehicle. We'll be right back.